Okay, it's time to start. Okay, welcome to the third lecture of linear algebra. And this lecture is not going to be assessed. Material of this lecture not going to be assessed. And it's not, I think it's not going to be used almost anywhere in this course, with maybe one small exception in the proof of one theorem. A little bit later, we're going to use complex numbers. In all other exercises, tutorial problems, homeworks, we're going to use only real numbers. So basically, this topic will not, you will not see complex numbers and finite fields in the exam. But I think this is very important lecture and important topics. Because it actually shows you, this lecture shows you that everything we're going to do in the linear algebra part of this course can be done over complex numbers, can be done over other numbers. And this is very useful. For example, complex numbers often helps us to understand the nature of the problem much better. And usually solutions of some problems using complex numbers are much simpler. And finite fields, I'll explain what it is, used in cryptography. So it's actually a very popular topic. And in other courses, for example, if you're taking accelerated proofs and problem solving, you will also learn a little bit about complex numbers and finite fields. Finite fields may be in disguise. It's called modular arithmetics, but it's the same thing. So basically, even if this lecture will not be assessed in this course, this lecture will help you to understand things better and also to help you, for example, for proofs and problem solving course and for fundamentals of pure math next semester. Okay, so let me remind you what is complex numbers, but before I do this, let me check how many of you actually already know what complex numbers are. So can you just put something in the chat, or you make some emotions, you just put thumbs up or anything, or upload. So I see that, yeah, if you already learn about complex numbers in high school, say something or show something. Yeah. Okay, good. Okay, good. Fine. Smiles are good. Okay, good. Perfect. So, okay, but I'm absolutely sure that even if you know what complex numbers are, some things in this lecture will be probably a little bit new for you. So let's see. So, but for everyone, let me remind that complex numbers informally can be constructed in this way. You take real numbers and you add a symbol, usually denoted by I traditionally, and you impose a new rule. You said that this symbol, its square is minus one. We know that there are no elements in real numbers such that its square is minus one. So we just add this element, and then we equip this larger set with a addition and multiplication operation. This larger set we denote by C. And this C is basically all the set of all possible sums like this, A plus BI. Yeah, so this part called imaginary part, this part called real part. So if B is zero, you can consider this complex number as a real number. So real numbers are subset of complex numbers. And then you equip this set with a naturally with addition. You just add real parts and imaginary parts, but you also can equip it with a multiplication, basically using just this rule and the usual rules of multiplication. Say if you take a product of these two complex numbers, you just get rid of brackets in the usual way, as we usually do. Yeah, and then you simplify the expression a little bit. Yeah, and then you have this formula. Again, this is nothing fancy. It's basically usage of this rule, I square is minus one. And this is for addition. Okay, So with complex numbers, you can actually do almost everything, actually basically everything we discussed over the last two lectures. You can consider vectors whose entries coordinates are complex numbers. You can consider matrices. It's absolutely no difference. It's basically the same thing as we discussed over the last two lectures. Sometimes maybe a little bit bulkier, but roughly the same. So, for example, most of you, I'm absolutely sure, capable of solving a system of two equations of degree one with real numbers. But for example, how to do this with complex numbers? So for example, if I erase all the complex numbers and I put real numbers, for example, you can erase imaginary parts, then I'm sure all of you can do this just basically by playing around. You don't need any theory. You just play around with these two equations and you find solution. Absolutely in the same way you can solve this complex equation, yeah? So for example, what your first move gonna be? Can you type something in the chat? If you want to solve this, what you're gonna do? Just use your intuition in a similar way as you would do if this were real numbers. Type in the chat what the first things your intuition tells you to do. Yeah, let me read. Separate imaginary, okay. I didn't think about this. I mentioned yesterday that every problem has many solutions. Every problem has many solutions. So what it was suggested to separate complex and imaginary parts, it's a good idea, but somehow I didn't think about this. So this is not what's on this slide. Basically, it's gonna replace this two equations into four equations with four unknowns in some sense, yeah, because X and Y also has to be split in the real and imaginary part. And then you're gonna have four equations, four unknowns, which I don't want to solve. It's just a bit too much, yeah. Second suggestion was to use matrices. Yeah, you can put this into matrix form, but this is too advanced. Let's do something low level. Yes, good. Find an expression of X and Y in terms of the other variable and the substitute in the second equation. Exactly. This is what most of us probably gonna do when you play with the real numbers. So let's just do the same here. So for example, you take one of this equation. Okay, I take the first one. And let's express X in terms of Y. You put this term on the right-hand side, and then you have to divide by 1 plus 5i. So this is the only difference with real numbers. With real numbers, we automatically divide like this. We do it subconsciously. But with complex numbers, you also can do it subconsciously, do it immediately if you have more experience. Yeah, we need to find how to divide by this number. And you just observe that if you take this number, 1 plus 5i, and if you multiply by this number, sometimes it's called complex conjugate, so you replace I to minus I, you get always a real number. In this case, it's 26. It's 1 square plus 5 square. But this means that if you want to divide by this number, it's the same as to multiply by this number and divide by 26. So basically, 1 over 1 plus 5i is also a complex number, which equals this one. Yeah, just because if you multiply this by this, you get one. This. So dividing by this number, it's the same as multiplying by this number. So let's just do this. So you do this, you multiply this equality by this, and you can express X. After simplification, you can express X in terms of Y. I did some simplifications here, so this is not a big deal. It's easy to actually, of course, it's a little bit more technical than the real numbers, but it's not much more difficult. It's just a little bit more work, but absolutely the same idea. Now we want to substitute this expression, for example, into second equation. And then we get rid of x and we have only one variable y. And then you play around and you find y, and then you use this expression to find x. Again, of course, it's more, a little bit more complicated than working with real numbers, but not much more complicated, just a bit. Yeah. So this is what I did. I substitute this into this equation. I get this very ugly expression, but you can simplify it. Yeah, you just put terms together in front of y, put terms together where you have don't have y, you separate them, you get this, and now you have to divide by this complex number. We already know how to find inverse of this complex number. You use the same trick. You just multiply by complex conjugate, you get real number, you divide, yeah, and then you get this a bit ugly expression, but I just put these numbers randomly. So this is why it's so ugly. Of course, if I put simpler looking complex numbers, all my computations gonna be a bit simpler. But of course, I cooked up this example using some computer algebra package. So all these computations are checked by computer. And you can actually also do this. For example, you can use any online computer algebra programs which can help you to solve problems like this. For example, MATLAB online or Wolfram Alpha. Okay, good. So this shows you that all linear algebra can be done over complex numbers in the same ways we it is done over real numbers. So this is just to remember for the rest of this course. We're not gonna do this basically just because real numbers looks a bit more traditional, it's simpler. You don't need to do this, all of this rather long, lengthy computations, but there are almost no difference. Moreover, as I already mentioned several times, and you will see this soon, and probably you already know this, complex numbers in some sense much better than real numbers. In most of pure mathematics, people prefer to use complex numbers rather than real. Okay, same way you can consider matrices with complex numbers. Yeah, for example, I just took these two matrices, basically randomly chosen. Yeah, and you can multiply them absolutely in the same way you multiply real numbers using absolutely the same rule. Of course, it's a little bit more computations, but theoretically and from abstract point of view, it's absolutely the same idea. It's not much more difficult. Yeah, it's a little bit more bulky, but not much more difficult. Yeah. Same way you can use a formula which we discussed last lecture to find inverse of 2x2 matrix. Yeah. You need to compute what is called determinant. We will discuss determinant later in more details, but for 2x2 matrices, we discussed it last lecture. Yeah, and you have divide by determinant, and then you basically swap these two entries, yeah, and you change signs of these two entries. And you can get matrix like this, and you can check its inverse of A. How to check this? You just multiply. You multiply A by this matrix, and you get identity matrix. You get matrix 1, 0, 0, 1, and this is a proof that this is inverse of A. Again, there are no big difference comparing to real matrices. It's absolutely the same. Okay, good. So what else can we do? Okay, since most of you, probably most of you said in the chat that you know how to you know complex numbers and you already met them in the school. I want to discuss one small thing on the next slide, basically, which it's a good test how good you know complex numbers. So for example, with real numbers, if you remember how you study real numbers in probably primary or high school, you first play with numbers a little bit, add, multiply, then you start solving equations, usually equation of degree one. And then at some point you find a formula for quadratic. And you learn in school how to solve quadratic equation. in one variable. So let's try to do the same here. For example, just we have this quadratic equation. Z squared, z is a variable, minus 4 minus 4i z plus 8 minus 4i, 14i. And we want to solve this equation when it find all z such that it's equal to 0. Yeah. Okay, so what would be the first step? Let's type something in the chat. What would you do if you're gonna solve this equation? What would you do? Yeah, let me read it. Make that explanation. Okay, someone really likes real numbers. This is actually, I must say that this is correct. Good idea. All ideas are correct, but this is a good idea. Yes, we at some point we split that as a real part and imaginary part, x plus iy. But okay, complete the square, use the quadratic formula. Absolutely fine. Yeah. So basically, all these three suggestions by you, I'm gonna use, but not in this order which that they appear in the chat. So basically, I first complete the square, then I get the quadratic formula, and then I split the variable as z as x plus y, iy. Okay, so I could do this in the beginning, but let me split the variable z a bit later. Okay, all advices are fine. The only problem with me is that I keep forgetting quadratic formula, so I always complete the square. It's impossible to forget how to complete the square. Yeah, but it's easy to forget any formula. Okay, good. So let's complete the square. So basically what I do, so I basically, just to show you how to do this in general, I called this guy to be B, this guy to be C, and then I can complete the square. Yeah, once I complete the square, I find the formula for the quadratic equation. Yeah, so z is minus b over 2 and plus square root of b square over 4 minus c. Yeah, so basically this is my quadratic formula. And now I'm a little bit stuck. Without your third advice. Third advice was perfect. Basically, why? Because if I want to find the square root of these complex numbers, there are several ways how to do this, but one way is just to split, in some sense, split the variable z, but basically, instead of splitting z, I just want to split variable to find the root, square root of this number. Again, you can leave probably the answer like this, but better get a better answer. Okay, so let me use the, there's someone late. Okay, let me use this third advice. So I consider the number x plus iy such that its square is minus 8 plus 6i. This is by definition square root of this number. Square root of this number, it's a complex number such that its square is minus 8 plus 6i. Yeah. So it's the same advice as before, but instead of splitting z, I split z minus 2 plus 2i. This is the same thing. Okay, good. So I split it like this. Yeah, and then I have this equality. But look, this equality, it's left-hand side and the right-hand side are two complex numbers, so they equal if and only if the real part equals and the imaginary parts equals. This gives me two equations. And here, x and y are real numbers. Starting from this line, there are no complex numbers. I just solving two real equations. And we do it in the intuitive way. How we basically in the same way how we solved linear equations on the previous slides. Yeah, you just express y in terms of x, you substitute here, you get this equation, you get this quadratic equation, it splits like this. It has two real roots, so we can ignore imaginary root because x is real. Yeah, and we have x is minus 1 or plus 1, and this gives me y plus or minus 3. So I get xy, so I found square root of this number. okay, this is it. And then I substitute square root in this formula and I get solution for my original quadratic equation. Yeah. Okay, so why I decided to consider this example? So first of all, because this is actually how you get used to complex numbers. You just play with them, you solve some problems. It's very similar problems which you solve in the high school or primary even school. I don't remember when people study quadratic, but over complex numbers. And you see, it's not much more difficult. It's a little bit probably more difficult than real numbers, but not much more. But this example show you the crucial difference between complex numbers and the real numbers. In real numbers, when we solve quadratic, we worry that the determinant, the discriminant of the quadratic equation is actually positive or non-negative. Otherwise, we cannot extract the root. Here, we actually do not care because we can always find the square root of any complex numbers. This is, you can prove this in a very similar way how we found square root of these complex numbers. You can just prove, it's a good exercise, prove that for every complex numbers, you can find the square root of this number. It always exists. In particular, this proves that every quadratic equation of a complex numbers with complex coefficients always has a root, and basically it's either two roots when discriminant is not zero, and when discriminant is zero, this equation usually become complete square, and then you have a one root, but we say one multiple root. Okay, this is a crucial difference between real numbers and complex numbers. This is why complex numbers are much better than real, because in real numbers you solve some polynomial equation and suddenly you don't have solution. This is not good. It's good, it's better, much better when you always have solutions. And this is the case for complex numbers. And this is a part of the big, very big theorem, which is has a name. It's called Fundamental Theorem of Algebra, which basically says that if you take any polynomial equation with complex coefficients, you always can find the root of this polynomial, solution of this polynomial equation. This is a striking difference comparing to real numbers. Yes, so basically this is a statement. If you have any polynomial in one variable with complex coefficient, you assume that first coefficient is not zero. Yeah, then if degree, of course, is bigger or equal than one, there's at least one root. Yeah, okay. And now, of course, if you remember from school how you can divide polynomials with remainders, using this division algorithm from this theorem, you can prove that every polynomial with complex coefficients splits as a product of polynomials of degree one. This follows, this corollary follows from this theorem using division with remainder. You just take this polynomial, this polynomial, you have find one root by this theorem, say lambda one, and you divide this guy by z minus lambda one with a remainder. But since it's degree one, remainder should be degree zero, but then you substitute lambda one and you get that the remainder is actually zero. And then you basically, what you proved that f of z divisible by z minus lambda one, and then you keep doing this and you get this corollary. Okay, so this is a big theorem. It's way outside the scope of this course. We're not gonna consider its proof or something or applications, but, and of course it's not gonna be assessed, but it's good to know. It's good to know this theorem. So it's good to know why complex numbers are much better than reals, because we have this theorem for complex numbers. We don't have this theorem for real numbers. Okay, good. This is called Fundamental Theorem of Algebra. Yeah. And okay, so this brings us to the more or less more general topic of this lecture. So as we consider real numbers, we consider complex numbers, and you can ask the question in general, can we consider linear algebra over other numbers? But instead of saying other numbers, mathematician introduced a name. The name is, it's a field. Mathematicians called a field a set with two operations, addition and multiplication, such that the set equipped with these operations behave very much the same as real complex numbers. So for example, if you take rational numbers, it's a field because absolutely the same properties. Or if you, for example, if you consider polynomials in one variable, for example, with real coefficients, it's not a field. Why? Because you cannot divide polynomials. There are no inverses. You say 1/x is not a polynomial. But if you consider what's called rational functions, so basically you consider fractions, polynomial over polynomial, then it's a field again. Yeah, and you can cook up many fields, and this is not going to be covered in this course, but you will deal with this later in honors algebra and a little bit maybe in fundamentals of pure math. But it's good to know what the name field means in pure mathematics. Yeah, basically field, it's a set with two operations. You can add numbers and multiply such that everything looks like we have the same rules as for real numbers or complex numbers. And to be precise, we have these 8 rules. You should have some special element 0, which behaves like 0. So you add the 0 to any number and you get the same number. You should have a special element 1, which behaves like 1. You multiply 1 by any number and you get any number. Yeah. And then you have usual addition rules, addition commutative, associative. You have the same rules for multiplications, and you have a rule, distributive rule. So basically how to get rid of brackets in the algebraic expressions. Yeah. And then existence of inverses. So for any number, we call element of the set numbers, but they're not necessarily numbers. They can be symbols or anything. Yeah, for any element, you should have element that looks like minus this element. So you add and you get 0. And with one exception, you can divide by any numbers. For any number, you have an inverse. For any number, say A, you should have number B such that say AB is 1. Yeah, with one exception, with 0. But we also know that with real numbers, you cannot divide by 0. So the same exception. Okay, and if all these properties are satisfied, again, intuitively, it means you designate one guy to be 0, you designate one guy to be 1, you have addition, you have multiplication, and then everything behaves like for real numbers. You can multiply, divide, add, subtract, yeah, but you have to stay within your set, of course, yeah. So this is usually called a field. It's very useful notions. We're not going to use it in this course, but it's good to know. And why it's good to know? Because a lot of things in linear algebra, actually almost everything in linear algebra can be repeated over any field. And if your field satisfies the same properties as complex numbers, if every polynomial equation has a root in this field, then everything in this course can be repeated for this field. Such fields are called algebraically closed fields. Okay, let's consider some example. It's very you can consider this as a game. Let's try to construct field consisting of 3 elements. These elements can be anything. It can be 3 shoes. Yeah, actually these examples, I consider this example with my daughter when she was 5. Basically we was in some shop and we took 3 different shoes. And we started to add shoes and subtract and multiply. Yeah, so you can actually do this, the same thing. So let's consider 3 symbols. Yeah, and we want to equip this set with addition and multiplication such that F becomes a field. Can I ask you to type in the chat basically the first thing you want to do to answer this question? So first of all, what do you think? Is answer is yes or no? Let's type yes or no in the chat. Just type yes or no, or I don't know. Or maybe guess. Okay, Yeah, let's try to guess. Type something, yes or no, absolutely without any reasoning, just what your intuition tells you. No, no, oh, it's good. Good, a lot of no's, oh, a lot of yes. Okay, it would be nice actually to have a vote. Okay, but okay, good. So let's just try. So first of all, we know that we should, if answer is yes, if answer is yes, to start with, we should decide which one of them gonna be zero. We should first start with the zero. So any suggestion which out of the three symbol we should choose to be zero? Let's type in the chat. Take the symbol you like the most and type, it's like type that it should be zero, yeah. Star, star, square, okay. Who is winning? Square is winning. Okay, we need more star supporters. Yeah. Square looks like a zero. Yeah, it's actually true. Square looks like a zero. This is correct. Okay. Sorry. I choose actually star to be zero. Yeah, sorry, my bad. And I choose square to be one. Yeah, my trick didn't work. I thought that majority gonna choose star, but okay, majority choose square. Okay, let it be. So I choose star to be zero and I choose square to be one. So then first let me consider addition and okay, multiplication as well. So look, just using my rules, if I add star to any of the symbols, I should get any of the symbols. So I get this line and this line. So this is called addition table. This is multiplication table. So in the entry of this table, you put result of addition of element, say the star plus star, star plus square. Yeah. So this line and this line immediately filled up by the rule. The star is my zero. Yeah. The only question is what should we put here? But then you play with other rules. For example, that it should be commutative. Yeah, then another rule that it should be, it should have an inverse. So you play around and you see that there's only one opportunity. You basically, this position of these symbols in this corner of this table, uniquely determined by rules on the previous slide. If I try to do something else, I get a contradiction. Okay, that's it. And absolutely the same, you fill this table. First, you prove that zero times something should be zero. It also follows from one of the rules on the previous slide. So it fills you this row in this column, and then you play around and you must get this. Otherwise, you cannot have anything else. Otherwise, you get a contradiction. Okay, so, and then this is not the end. Then you have to accurately check that with this addition, with this multiplication, all the rules on the previous slide are satisfied. Yeah. A white triangle plus square is a star. Okay, look, to be precise, you have to prove this. Look, if triangle plus square should be something. If triangle plus square, okay, let me just write it down. Let me stop sharing. Yeah, so we have triangle, star, star is my zero, and we have a square, and this is my one. We want to prove, claim, triangle plus star. Wait. What it says? Sorry. Wait, what was the question? Triangle plus star. Let me just read the chat again. So wait. Triangle plus square is a star. Yeah, wait. Let me go back. Triangle plus square is a star. Why? Okay, look, we have only three symbols. This, that, and that. Yeah, so proof. Suppose this is not true. Okay. Then we have two choices. First choice, triangle plus square is triangle, or triangle plus square is square. Yeah. If this is not true, one of this has to be true. We have only three symbols. But look, we use the axiom that triangle has a inverse with respect to addition. You can have, there's an element among the three such that triangle plus what we call minus triangle, it's one of these guys, it's a zero. Zero is my star. Okay, so yeah, I add this symbol. I don't know what it is. It's one of them. I add it to the left-hand side and the right-hand side. Yeah, and I get square plus star equals star. Yeah, but I use the axiom that square plus star plus square is a square because my star is a zero. Okay, so I proved that square is a star. No. These are three different symbols. Contradiction. Absolutely in the same way you obtain contradiction in this case. It's the same way. I just use several rules which must be satisfied this to be a field. Okay, that's it. Okay, so let me stop sharing and let me go back to slides. Okay, so this, thank you. It's a very good question. Everything on this slide has to be proved. This is not obvious. But what I want to say, this, what I said, it follows from the rules on the previous slide. If you just change something in these tables, you obtain a contradiction. Okay, good. So let's, of course, but of course this way constructing fields are not, how to say, not very illuminating, not maybe, doesn't look scientific, doesn't look logical. It just looks like we're playing around and something. It looks a bit difficult in general to be applied in general settings. So let's consider some more unified approach to constructing fields with finitely many elements. Such fields called finite. If you have a field with a finitely many elements, it's called finite. Okay, basically, let me just show you another way how to obtain this, construct this example, but in a better way, so that you can construct fields with more elements. Yeah. Okay, so you fix some prime number P, and you consider the set consisting of P integers from 0 to P minus 1. P is a prime. And let's call this set FP for simplicity. Yeah. And now we just want to have a unified rule how to equip this set with addition multiplication in a unified way, such that it works for every prime. And you do this. You take two elements and you add them as integers. But if you add them as an integer, it may happen that you get a larger integer, so which is not good. It should be one of these numbers. So if a plus b is one of these numbers, fine, you just keep it this way. But if a plus b is larger than p minus 1, you take a remainder of a plus b when divided by p. And remainder must be less than p. So you get number in this list. In the same way you define multiplication. Okay, and one can show, it's a good exercise. You will prove this in proofs and problem solving, not in this course, that using these two operations, addition and multiplication, this set becomes a field. And of course, if P is three, it's going to be just the field considered on the previous slide. But in this case, this is going to be just 0, 1, and this is 2. Yeah. And if P is 2, this is field of two elements. Sometimes it's called bit strings. It's used very, this field is very important for computer science, for cryptography. Yeah. Okay, good. And this is, for example, example. You take this number, 1973. One can check its prime. We can Google it. Yeah. And then, for example, one can show that A divided by 45, it's A times 570. So it basically means 45 times 570, it's 1 NFP. So it means that the remainder, when you divide by P, is 1. How to check this? You just multiply and divide. We all know how to divide integers with remainders, so you can check this. Yeah. How to, there's, for example, if you ask me how to do this in general, how to find this? So you might ask me, how did you find it? How did you find it? There are two ways how to find, for example, inverse of 45 in this field. One way, you just go through all numbers. You have just 1,973 numbers. You can write one line script in any computer language which you like. And you go through this big set and you just check when you get some number in the set, such that when you multiply by 45, you get integer whose remainder is 1 when you divide by p. All computer languages are capable of doing this, just one line script. So this is not a big difficult, not very difficult. But there is, of course, more logical, more scientific way how to do this. And this is you also going to learn in proofs and problem, accelerated proofs and problem solving. Maybe you already learned it. I don't know. Or maybe you're going to learn it in next week or something. So this is called Euclidean algorithm. But we're not going to do this. It's not important for us. For us, it's important that such number 570, it exists always. Okay, good. So this gives you a lot of fields, infinitely many finite fields. So let's just play with one of them. I took F7. Seven is a nice number. Yeah, so for example, goal of this next three slides is to show you that everything we can do with real numbers, usually we can do with finite fields. It's actually with finite fields, it's a bit simpler. Yeah, so for example, suppose we want to solve this system of equations. Here, logic is absolutely the same as in the example with complex numbers. You just express x using the first equation in terms of y, substitute to the second equation, you get y, and then you use the first equation to get x. Yeah, so this is basically copy-paste of the slide which I already used, but I just replaced numbers. Yeah. First, you want to find the inverse of 2. We want to divide by 2. It means we have to multiply by a number such that 2 times this number is 1. How to find it? We just have 7 numbers in F7. Just go through all of them and check. This is not a big issue. Yeah, like 2 times 4, it's 1. Why? Because 2 times 4 is integer, it's 8. And 8, when you divide by 7, it's 1. Remainder is 1. Okay, so 1 over 2 is 4 in F7. Yeah, and then this allows you to express x. You just multiply this expression by 4. You get this guy with a minus sign. You put on the right-hand side, yeah, 3y. And this is x. Then you simplify. 4 times 5 is an integer, is 20. As an integer is 20, but 20 modulo 20 has a remainder 6 when you divide by 7, yeah, because it's 14 plus 6. And similarly, 4 times 3 is 12, but 12 is 4 by 3 is 12, but it's 12 is 5 in F7 because remainder is 5. And then you take minus, you need to find the number such that you add to 5. And you get 0 in F7. So this is 2. 2 plus 5 is 7. So remainder is 0. Yeah. Okay. So, and then you substitute into the second equation. You simplify. You get this. And then you want to divide by 3. You need to find the inverse of 3, but it's inverse of 3 is 5 because 3 times 5. Is 15 as an integer, but it's 14 plus 1. So remainder when you divide by 7 is 1. Yeah. So you multiply this by 5, you get y equal 5 times 4. We already checked that this is 6. Yeah. We found y and we use first expression, this expression to get x. Okay, this, oops, sorry, this give us solution. So you see, it's actually simpler in some sense than simpler than what we did with complex numbers. And I think it's even simpler than with real numbers. Absolutely in the same way you can play with matrices. Yeah. So for example, take these matrices, you want to multiply them, assuming that we're working not with the numbers, we're working with elements of this field F7. We just multiply and you always keep taking remainder when you divide by seven, yeah. Also, one can check that both matrices is not invertible. And of course, the reason for this, as we explained, I explained last lecture, that determinant is zero. Yeah, for example, determinant of this matrix is zero as an integer. Determinant of this matrix is seven as an integer, but seven is zero in F7. So, okay, good. And you can also check it. You multiply these two guys, this matrix, and this matrix, you get a zero matrix. It implies that B is not invertible. If B were invertible, then you can multiply this equality on the right-hand side by the inverse of B. You should get identity here. And then you get 4, 1, 5, 3 equal zero times something. Zero times something is zero. So you would get a contradiction. Okay, absolutely the same way you can solve quadratic equation. No, not a big difference. Yeah, you just, it's a copy paste of the previous slide. I just complete the square, play around, and then I get this expression. And now the only difference with complex and real numbers is the question is how to find root of 2 and F5. Again, root of 2 is a number in F5, if it exists, whose square is 2. Yeah, please type in the chat any idea how to find root of 2 in F5. Sorry, it's not F5, it's F7. It's a typo. I assume it's F7. This is typo, F7. Please type in the chat any suggestion how to find root of 2 in this field. Again, we have seven elements in the field. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's it. We're looking for any of them such that its square is 2. Any suggestion how to do this? Hello. Type something. Yes, someone type something. 4, find a number that squares. Yeah. Find a number that squares to be 2. Yeah. Okay. Use minus 2. Okay. Okay. Good. All suggestions are good. Basically, again, we have seven numbers. So we just take squares of all of them. I just take 0 square, 0, not 2. 1 square, 1, not 2. 6 square, 1, not 2. 2 square, 4, not 2. 5 square, 4, not 2. 3 square, 2. 4 square, 2. 3 square is 9, but 9, again, when you take multiplication in F7, you take remainder when you divide by 7. So 3 times 3 is 9. It's an integer, but it's in our, using our rule, it's actually 2. The same 4 square, because 4 is actually minus 3. Okay, so we got root of 2 is 3, 4. So we get 5, 6. Yeah, actually you can solve this equation without any quadratic formula, without completing a square. You can just take all these seven numbers and substitute here and check whether it's zero or not. So to be precise, you can completely ignore what's on this slide. You can just substitute seven numbers here and find the root. Sometimes you have a root, sometimes not. Not every polynomial has a root in F7. It's not algebraically closed. Okay, so basically this is almost it. I have 1 minute left. And okay, so we found fields consisting of P elements where P prime. Of course, one can ask, can we find fields with other number of elements? And the answer is yes, but not in this way. So for example, we consider field with four elements. We can do it absolutely in the same way how we found a field of three elements. We just play around. We designate one of these guys to be zero, one of these guys to be one, and then we can try to fill multiplication addition table, and we get this tables. Yeah, but this is not a conceptual way. There are much more direct, more algebraic way how to construct the field of an element, but it's more abstract. So I put it in the slides, but I don't have time to talk about this, only if you ask me a question after the lecture. And I'll upload the slides, you can read it yourself, or we can discuss it after the lectures, like basically question and answers, yeah. But let me stop sharing. Let me just say another important thing why I decided to discuss today finite fields, because one can prove there's a theorem. I put it in the slides that let me go to this theorem. Let me just scroll down and go to the final slide here. So basically one can use the results which we're going to learn in the next 4 weeks to prove the following very nice theorem. If you have a finite field that it must contain p to the power of n elements, where p is a prime and n is some positive entity. Yeah, so for example, you cannot have field consisting of 6 elements. But to prove this, you have to use linear algebra over finite fields. And it's not very complicated, but you're all going to be able to prove this in maybe 4 or 5 weeks. Yeah. And what is more interesting, so this gives you all fields. So actually for every prime, for every integer, positive integer, there exists a field consisting of p to the power of n integers, p to the power of n elements. But this is more difficult actually to prove this theorem than this. This you will be able to prove. This is probably you're going to be able to prove an Honors algebra. Yeah, and one can also show that such field consisting of p to the n elements is unique up to relabeling the elements. If you just change the name of the elements, it's going to be unique. It's a good exercise to try to construct field of 8 elements. Okay, let me stop. Lecture is over. So now feel free to ask any question. Let me probably stop recording. Yeah.